Many thanks for joining us again today. My name is Dapo Aruajoye. We're looking at how to have a responsible police force this morning, how to have responsible police officers, even most especially the ones that carry firearms. You may recall of recent, we have cases of police accidental discharge from police, and some could be voluntary or deliberate discharge. Talking about the ones that happened, the one that happened in K2, where you have a policeman that killed the three young men. We will play you that report, but let me first introduce our guest this morning. I have on my left, Malachi Ogumadu, is the National President, CDHR. That's the Committee for Defense and Human Rights. Thank you very much for joining us. And also I have Okechukwu Nwaguma, is a National Coordinator, NOPREN Foundation. NOPREN is a Network on Police Reform Nigeria. Thank you also, Okechukwu.
My pleasure to be here. Thanks.
Okay, let's take a look at this clip, this report by a correspondent, a crime correspondent, Ivy Kano.
Some sympathizers were seen discussing in hushed tones at the 3 Dairo Street, K2 Lagos residence, of 3 friends shot dead by police officer on Boxing Day. The deceased, identified as twin brothers Taiwo and Kehinde Oyesunle, and their friend, simply known as JJ, shared a 3-bedroom flat here.
How would you describe JJ?
Very cool-headed guy. I'm surprised. I'm speechless. I didn't know what to say because he has been a very quiet guy since I know him.
And I know the twins and the other guy, JJ. They are quiet living guys and they are not caught. That's all I can depend on them.
I was supposed to be there. I wanted to get up and come, prepare myself. I don't just know the spirit that kept me home.
I've been a lot of complaint about the mopo. That is how I used to behave. Especially when he's drunk. And I think the manager is supposed to have done something about that issue.
For the over 80-year-old mother of the twins, losing Taiwo and Kehinde, her only children, means life is no longer worth living. According to her, having lost their father, they were all she had, and she had looked forward to them looking after her until God calls her.
I saw them 2 days ago when they brought Christmas food. They also came yesterday, but I couldn't see them because I was in church. Whatever government can do to assist is okay by me, since I don't have anyone to assist me.
Bloodstains and bullet holes were visible at number 8 Anibaba Street, where Paulson Hotel is located.
Well, we're still reaching you from Anibaba Street number 8, where the tragedy struck yesterday. The blood of the innocent still litters the ground and broken bottles everywhere. I call it Boxing Day tragedy.
Eyewitnesses spoke on what transpired on that fateful day.
There were 3 guys here. They came to the hotel. So they walked out, they got a cigarette from the kiosk here, because they were here taking the cigarette. So the mupo, the man that at the gate here was manning the hotel, came to them, tried to dislodge them from here. So I think there was a little argument. At that point, I already shot a guy, nicknamed JJ, shot him on the foot. So are you getting it? So he now dragged, the guy was still bleeding. That guy he shot was still bleeding, so they moved. You can see the traces of blood.
Okay.
These are the traces of blood. Okay. So after they got to the gate there, so when the argument was that much, as one of the twin brother was like, you shouldn't have shot. That was the argument. You shouldn't have shot someone. It's not right to do that. Are you getting it? So he was threatening to shoot the guy at the same time. He shot. There's a bullet there. He shot. Okay. The guy originally escaped. There's a shot here.
There's a particular place I saw
full
of blood, but it's already dried.
Yes. They now argue to that point. That was where he shot one of the twins. He shot the guy dead. Are you getting it? But realizing that the guy was dead, I don't know, he withdrew back.
Okay.
Are you getting it? Mm. So the guy he shot on the foot was trying to rescue that guy on the floor.
Okay.
That was when he now shot the guy again, like twice.
We brought shot them twice?
He shot the guy twice. He shot him there once, and he shot him again here, making 2 dead bodies. So the other twins were trying to escape. He followed him up to that point and shot him. and he was trying to enter the hotel. It was one of my friends here that shot the gate against him.
We were coming out, we heard a gunshot, and we thought, and we came out, we saw the policeman. The guy looks so drunk, and I tried to avoid conversation with him. And so he now went out and said, I'll kill all the criminals in this place. He went out and said, he cocked his gun. I just left my car there. I went somewhere else to go and watch the game.
We saw some people coming out from the hotel. So we saw the mopo cocking the gun. So just like that, he shot the first person. Then the second person, because they say they are twins. Then the second person was saying, tie, 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 tie. When the guy was doing tie, tie, he wanted to raise his second. He now shot the other guy. That one that they are calling JJ, the one he shot last. The one that he have killed two people, that one want to run. Because the bike man went to go and stay down, and we are there. So the third person want to run. He now follow the third person again and shot him. Then after that, he now come back to these twins. He now shot himself this side, now go down.
Meanwhile, the police say while they sympathize with families of the deceased men, they would like the public to know that the officer acted in clear violation of police ethics.
Look at me well. Everybody right here, because remember here, inside the same only one house, neighbor room, you can see the people, you are the custom member. I like what, get you, possession. Look at me, because you remember.
Ivy Khan, TVC News, Lagos.
A sad one there, a sad one. But the Inspector General of Police, Solomon Arase, maybe in view of all this, spoke about the reform of the Nigerian police force.
We have already procured some kits, some medical kits, so we'll do some, you know, spot checks. Whenever our men are deployed, we'll do some spot checks to make sure that, you know, they don't have substance in their system that will impair their judgment. It is when judgments are impaired that, you know, you have issues of this accidental discharge.
Impaired judgment. Let me go to you, Malaki. This is not the first, it's not the last of recent two. Is it not one too much? What do you think?
Well, my heart goes out to the mother, aged mother of those twins. By the way, I'm a twin. And the entire family members. But I think we should take it off from where President Olusegun Obasanjo just stopped. He was categorical in one of his remarks when he said that there are a lot of bandits recruited into the Nigerian police force. If you remember also that there are quite a number of these cases. I have been, you know, severally to many places, not just as a lawyer, but in our work also as a leader of a rights organization, Committee for the Defense of Human Rights. The worrying aspect is that at the end of the day, you hardly would hear any credible, explicable reasons why these kind of dastardly act took place. Almost like what you find in Lagos, heavy traffic, you get to the end and you see nothing.
Nothing.
Now, it's okay for the Inspector General of Police. Indeed, I had engaged the DIG in charge of admin then, Doma. I had engaged him and said, look, it seemed to me that the hierarchy of the Nigerian police force at the moment is sensitive to the crisis in the force. But they should also look into the cases of extrajudicial killings. And it is not just about talking about it. It is about checking out the recruitment processes. Even the reportage that was given regarding the Nigerian Police College, the training centers, would clearly confirm to you why these people are not expected, except those who are exceptionally committed to nation nationhood and nation building, why many of them cannot come out and then discharge their responsibility with all sense of humanity.
In short, function properly. Is that what you're saying?
That is the point. Now, again, what is the category of people who seek recruitment into the Nigerian police force? Up until very recently, you can only associate the Nigerian police force with a collection center for droppers or those who are never hopeful that they can ever, you know, get any meaningful
means in the society.
In the society. And then you capture them, you gather that bracket and dehumanize them in the first place in the name of training. My elder brother, late now, a medical doctor, did his housemanship in the Nigerian police college here. And I had the privilege of staying there for a while. And it dawned on me why these people are out there. And so it's good that the IG is talking the way he's talking. But I think that he also needs effective collaboration beyond the report he gets. Because we've seen it all. You stay in that Olympian height, dream well about the force that you lead.
Yes.
Yet, you get, you know, reports that clearly undermine the enormity of the crisis.
Let me
essentially hear. From people who wants to maintain the status quo. Because what is it? If the police colleges are not properly equipped,
yes,
as we now know in our society, people are responsible for that.
I know. Let me go to Okechukwu, because you in charge of the reform of the police force. Have you seen it all also? Because he said that even the IG must have seen it all. But have you seen it all? And he made mention of the fact of that the recruitment process. I've seen clips whereby you have the trainers use sticks to hit the head. Have you seen that? The head of the recruits. Where they were 20 people share one fish. Have you seen that also?
Yeah, you know, just like my brother, my colleague, I just said, you know, you can't expect people who go through the type of dehumanization that we see, you know, police trainees in police, you know, in fact, as a matter of fact, if you go to those training, you know, in colleges, what you find is squalor, just as what you see in police, you know, where they live, you know. Now, the thing goes back to, just like he started by saying, to the process of recruitment. There is a standard process of, requirements before anybody can be recruited into the police. For instance, you talk about the need to do a background check on the individual.
Is that always done, or that's
everything
in a sane circumvented environment?
Of course,
okay.
Circumvented,
including their certificates.
They don't do.
They don't answer their names.
A lot of them are not trainable because a lot of them don't even have the minimum educational requirements. So a lot of them. That is why all the training, for whatever it is worth, doesn't reflect any, because a lot of them are not trainable. There are people who cannot even comprehend. And then in terms of a lot of them, for instance, he made reference to Obasanjo. You know that during the 16 years of military rule, there was no police recruitment. Now, when Obasanjo came to power, he ordered, there was need to make up for the shortfall in manpower. Because at that time, in 1999, Nigerian police had less than 200,000 men, in fact, about 150 something. Now, to make up for this shortfall, there was a recruitment drive, massive recruitment drive. The policy then was to recruit 40,000 for a year, for a period of 5 years, between 2000 and 2004.
That's like almost 250?
Now, after the first year, he had to order a moratorium on further recruitment. And why? Just like he said, criminals and misfits have found their way into the Nigerian police force, because they did an audit and found out that more than half of the whole number recruited had people who wrote their exams for them, who did their tests for them. They couldn't spell their names. That is why, as we speak today, there are police officers who cannot make, you know, make correct
statements.
Yeah. Mm. And so this whole idea of police officers drinking alcohol, a lot of them are drug addicts. Mm. The alcoholics, they wear uniform and carry arms, and you find them in Bia Palace. Every morning you see them in Baraga, you know, joint. They drink and get drunk. And these are people who are given arms. So they become threat to public safety rather, you know, protectors.
Okay. He said they knew that we have misfits in the police force, and most of these people are still giving firearms. And the AIG said that you have impaired judgment. How can you have a man? Number one, you know, he might be a misfit. Number two, he's drunk or he's high on any substance. And to add insult on injury, you have firearms in the arm of that person.
Well, the possibility of that is the incidence or incidences of extrajudicial killings that did not just start today. I mean, if we begin to pick them out, we won't focus on the grain of this discussion. I think that, you know, listening to Mr. Arasi, a lawyer for that matter, I think he means well. Mm. I've also talked to my people on the need to find a way of lending credence to some of the things he has been doing since he came on board. Indeed, I've met the principal staff officer last month, and I say we will identify with you publicly on two key issues. One, these avowals of total zero tolerance to corruption and respect for the fundamental rights of the Nigerian people. On those two calls, yes. But we also have the capacity to monitor the very devastating incidences of rights abuses and this corruption. Therefore, you keep your parallel lines of communication and reportage. We can also supply you with our own independent objective reportage. That way, you cross-check and balance it out, and then have an informed position, because it is one thing to dream big, but if the communication is cut off, you are likely going to get a report by the majority of those who want to keep the status quo.
Yeah. And was that received from you? Was that advice?
I mean, I'm just telling you what is on the ground. Mm-hmm. We yet to. Now, why do we feel compelled to do this? The Nigerian Police Force, under Section 214 of the Constitution, is the institution of government that is saddled with the responsibility of securing the country internally. Forget what Boko Haram has turned our society into. Mm-hmm. Any civilized society is secured by the police.
Yes.
Yeah.
And therefore, for as long as you have this degree, mark my word, high degree of dissident elements
in the force,
for that long, our work will be much more difficult. And come to think of it, 80-year-old woman, no husband, with just two kids, twins, gone for the day. Mm-hmm. The repercussion of that on the society, which you are supposed to secure, is unimaginable. And therefore, I expect that issues such as this should be given. Look, by now, the same hierarchy of the police should be giving us updates about the outcome of the investigation or what further steps have been taken by the police. That way, you are switch the fears of the populace, because once the fear is eroded, there is no basis for collaboration. You can get the intelligence with which you can work. They don't feel protected by you, and then you resort to self-help.
Wait, but can that fear be eroded? Now, the IG is saying that a psychiatric test should be conducted on even the new recruits and even existing officers. How do we do that?
Because these are already part of the requirements. You know, it is not because something has happened and then you now say, because it is required that before you recruit anybody into a sensitive organization like
yes,
the police,
please,
you need to check his mental makeup, his, you know, health, mental, you know, mental makeup. You want to, so that you don't unleash mad people on the society. And so, but all these are not done. And then, this apart from doing it at the point of training and recruitment, periodic checks ought to be done. So that before you even arm somebody, give somebody arms, you know, you need to be sure that this person is.
But that should be the norm.
There's no enforcement.
Does that happen?
That is the point. It doesn't happen.
So if I want to join the police force today, I just join the
police. All you need to do is pay bribe. Mm-hmm. And you find your way into the police.
I just bribe myself.
That is
inside.
What happens. Unfortunately, that is what happens.
And they don't even need to know I know anything.
Let's even paint the poverty of the situation lot more graphically. The bribe thing. Secondly, if you are going to conduct a background check on an impostor, how do you arrive at the answer? I am telling you that most of the policemen, at least 20, 25 to 30 policemen, don't answer their name.
Yeah.
The reason is that if you are expected to produce a certificate
or a document from your document from local government local chairman government, or, you know,
and you don't have any, the that use the certificate of others and supply to the institution, in which case you are going to conduct a background check on a fictitious person. So meanwhile, you are recruiting a madman, like he said.
A madman.
In the U.S. today, besides the election coming up later in the year, the most disturbing trend today is the issue of gun control.
Yeah.
President Obama has had Herculean tasks
trying
to push that control because of the bipartisan Congress resistance. How much has this United States lost in the past 6 months to, deranged, demented persons? It has now become fashionable, almost a play of a sort, that young people in their teens can walk into colleges, public places,
and gun people down.
Yeah. So the issue of background check, if the police cannot do it, who will do it? If the police cannot go beyond just accepting a certificate without a corresponding check to ascertain the authenticity of that certificate in relation to the person presenting it, who else will do it?
Malachi, what so then will do if, the fate if of a police officer is dismissed, maybe in Kaduna, he can then leave and come to Lagos and recruit
it
again, be recruited again into the system.
It does happen.
As a matter of fact, even to help you in that line of thought, is to say that many of them don't even bother. You don't bother getting recruited again. You just relocate to and then keep wearing the uniform.
Yeah,
and just continue like that.
We are aware of this. Mm-hmm. Now, what did we do? At the level of the Committee for Defense of Human Rights, when His Highness Emmanuel Adebayo was the Commissioner of Police in Lagos State, I was the General Secretary of this organization. It was a long drawn campaign, and we compelled them to set up the human rights decks in all the police stations in Lagos State. This can be replicated all over the country. As we speak, there are human rights desks in offices in all the police stations in Lagos State.
And
whether they are doing it optimally as they ought to, but that was a starting point. And we're saying that can be sustained. The reason for sustaining that is to be able to also hype and raise the bar regarding the discipline that you can introduce into the.
Again,
there are some of them, many of them indeed, that are not just upright, sincere, I'm talking of policemen, and are ready for the business of nation building. Such people can be singled out and rewarded.
So we have the bad eggs, but it seems like the bad eggs are like, they have a higher percentage. Is that what we are saying here?
No, the logical outcome of the process of recruitment is what we have. You know, because a situation where just like there's even no database, there's no forensic capability in the first place to even, you know, deal with crime. So it all goes back to the whole issue of lack of record keeping, lack of database, lack of.
So even forensic. The biometrics is not there. Someone that has to carry guns, we don't even have these details on the computer.
If police, our police today as it is, can compromise crime scenes, then what else do you want to understand why you know
compromise deliberately? Yes.
Well, maybe not deliberately, but because of lack of competence, incompetence, lack of forensic
they were not
capability.
Trained
lack of training yes, you know, so it all goes back to
now let's not sound completely despondent about the situation, essentially because we're all in it together. If our society is no longer policed, it will mean that we're all in for it, because the absence of security is the last bus stop before anarchy. That's the way I like to put it. And therefore, it is to really encourage these people. I'm aware that there are deliberate efforts in the leadership of the police to get in place some of these things. They are embracing ICT. They are embracing some innovations that will mitigate the incidences that has completely undermined their integrity and position in the country. And therefore, what we will be calling the leadership to do is to, as they deal out, dish out policies and reforms and all that, is to take some of these specific cases, and they are quite rampant all over the country.
They are quite.
We have, look, when I was with Mr. Femi Falana, where I had my tutelage, the second year, a case was assigned to me. And that has to do with a driver who was unable to provide the usual, it was 20 naira then.
Hmm.
Is it 20 or 20 naira as at that time. And he thought that it was a joke. This contingent of policemen had been drafted from the north. He didn't understand the grammar the young boy was, I say, because he was pleading that I'm just coming from, it was early in the morning, from the mechanic where we had our cars. Can I just do one turn? And before he knew it, as he was making those explanations, he was cocking the gun. Using with a lot of alcohol. And before you knew it, he shot, it was the pellets hit the driver's eye and damaged it.
Wow.
Then we took the matter to the Federal High Court.
Can you continue this story after this short break? Very well. I need to go on a short break. When you come back, you can definitely continue. Just stay with us, please.